Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It had been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It had been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It had been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that they're Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language since some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, He is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart, to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abide within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof of that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Six is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the midst of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Will Williams, a scripture lesson of Jonah the first chapter by Dr. Ethan Williams.
Morning class. Let's bow our hearts and our minds. O Yahweh, we're just grateful to be able to gather again in your name to learn more of your purpose and plan, and that according to your divine pattern. We just humbly ask that you pour out among us more knowledge, more intelligence, more information, but most importantly, just simply give us a better understanding so that we may be able to stand in these latter days, without spot and blemish in that last day in your eyesight, so that we may be able to go forward and live eternally with you, in you, be you. These things that we hope and we ask for, and other things you see that we sorely stand in need of. In the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah, it's all so.
Hallelujah. Morning, class.
Good morning.
I will be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts provided by the late A.B. Traynor. I'll be reading Jonah, the first chapter. Now the word of Yahweh came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of Yahweh, and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof, and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of Yahweh. But Yahweh sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid, and cried every man unto his idol, and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea, to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay, and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came to him, and said unto him, What meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy Elohim, if so be that Elohim will think upon us, that we perish not. And they said every one to his fellow, Come, and let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell upon Jonah. They said unto him, Tell us, we pray thee, for whose cause this evil is upon us. What is thine occupation, and whence comest thou? What is thy country, and of what people art thou? And he said unto them, I am an Hebrew, and I fear Yahweh, the Elohim of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. Then were the men exceedingly afraid, and said unto him, Why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of Yahweh, because he had told them. Then said they unto him, What shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. And he said unto them, Take me up, and cast me forth into the sea, so shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not. For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. Tempestuous against them. Wherefore they cried unto Yahweh and said, We beseech thee, O Yahweh, we beseech thee. Let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon us innocent blood. For thou, O Yahweh, hast done as it pleased thee. So they took up Jonah, and cast him forth into the sea. And the sea ceased from her raging. Then the men feared Yahweh exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice unto Yahweh, and made vows. Now Yahweh hath prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. That was Jonah, the first chapter.
Hallelujah.
Our first speaker this morning will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As always, it's a pleasure to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. I'm happy to see that some of us that haven't seen in a while is here today. And I hope everything is going well with your family. And I'm going to touch on a few things and lay a solid foundation about something that's been on my heart and mind. Now, this whole thing is about we all coming to a profound understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose and His pattern and His plan of salvation. You see? And what we want to do is utilize the tools that Yahweh has given us to come to an understanding of His teaching. Now, our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, said he had a divine vision and revelation direct from Yahweh. He said, don't believe me because I said, but make me prove it to your satisfaction. And what he did, he labored for some 45 years preaching the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. And what he did, he showed us how to go into this Bible and to line it up and utilize the pattern that was laid down, you see, in the Bible. And prior to him coming along, folks knew about the tabernacle, but they did not know how to understand and to utilize this pattern. Now, then we have Revelation, I think it was 19 and 10. Now, listen, first of all, what the founder told us was this. There was a pattern that was given to Moses, you see, when he was called up to the mount. And he told us that he gave him divine specification on how to build and construct this tabernacle pattern. And that we have to use this pattern as a tool to understand something about Yahweh and the divine purpose. He also told us that we have to go back and utilize the law and the prophets, you see, which is a witness. The first five books of your Bible was written by Moses, which is the law.
Right.
And then from Joshua on down to Malachi is the prophecy. And if someone's not teaching you by the law and the prophets, simply, they just don't know and they don't simply understand the basic fundamental principles of Yahweh's divine purpose and His pattern and His plan. Thirdly, the founder utilized the creation. I'm talking about the sun, moon, and stars and all things therein to use as a witness, you see, to prove and vindicate that there is a Yahweh. And finally, he gave us a physical body. By utilizing our own physical body, we're going to use that as a tool. Now the question is, what are you going to use to disprove what we're talking about? We've got the creation and all things therein, including you and your physical body, and a Bible, you see, that was written by Yahweh himself, and then we got a pattern he gave us to use as a slide rule to come to an understanding of his purpose. Right. Now, we're going to go to John, who's on the Isle of Patmos, you see, and he is a witness, you see, to Moses, who was called up into the mountain, you see, whereby he had three trips to the mountain. Now, Moses saw the purpose from the beginning all the way down to the end, and then also, John saw the purpose from the end all the way back to the beginning, you see. Now, I know I call Revelation, but before I do that, I want to have 2 Corinthians 13. Matter of fact, let's move on. Let's go ahead and read it. Pick it up right there. Now, here's John on the Isle of Patmos, you see, who's having a divine vision of Revelation, and this is what he said.
2 Corinthians 13.
No, hold on. Revelation. Go ahead.
Revelation
19
and 10.
Revelation 19 and 10.
And I fell at his feet.
Now, John said he fell at his feet because he saw, you see, Yahweh Elohim. You see, fully clothed. Read, please.
To worship him.
Read on.
And he said unto me,
read.
See thou do it not.
Read on.
I am thy fellow servant.
He says, I am thy fellow servant. Read on.
And of thy brethren,
read,
that have the testimony of Yahshua.
Read on.
Worship Yahweh.
Worship Yahweh. Read on.
For the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy.
Now the testimony of Yahshua Messiah is the spirit of prophecy.
So we got to go back and utilize the tools that Yahweh gave us to understand something about Yahweh's divine purpose and entire plan. 2 Peter 3 and 8. 2 Peter 1 and 19. Now we're going to go to another divine authority, which is Peter, who also walked with Yahshua Messiah, and so did John, you see, who was also an apostle. As a matter of fact, he was the youngest of all the apostles and the last one to die.
Yeah.
You see. Read, please.
2 Peter 1:19.
Read.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Now we also have a more sure word of prophecy. Read on.
Whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place.
In other words, the light is Yahshua Messiah, who says, I am the light. Mm-hmm. You see, the dark place that we're talking about right now is a man's consciousness, not your closet. You see, but it's the man's consciousness. You see, we come to find out that the darkest place in the universe is the man's consciousness. But the light that shines in darkness is Yahshua Messiah. You see, read please.
Take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day that star arise in your
the
heart.
The day star, which is the sun. You see, not the S-U-N. The S-U-N is a type of shadow of the S-O-N, who is Yahshua Messiah. Just as this physical sunlight illuminates the entire creation, likewise, you see, it's going to be Yahshua Messiah that's going to illuminate your creation or your earth. Let's read, please.
Knowing this first.
Read on.
That no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
Read on.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but only holy men of Yahweh spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
So the holy men of Yahweh spake as they was moved by the Holy Spirit. Now you know how we are. Mm-hmm. We'll say, well, I don't believe in the Bible because men wrote the Bible. Mm-hmm. You see, men ain't wrote squat.
That's right.
Only thing they did was Yahweh utilized them just as you pick up a pen and you pen a paper. Right. But holy men of Yahweh spake and they was moved by the Holy Spirit. Matter of fact, you still over there, Peter?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Go back to school to 16.
16.
Yeah.
2 Peter 1:16.
Read.
For we have not followed cunningly devised fables.
In other words, it's not Aesop's. Aesop's. Fables, you see, little sayings and so. These men wrote as this one, talking about Yahshua Messiah, you see, told them what to write, how to write, and when to write. Keep reading.
Well, we made known unto you the power and coming of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
Read.
But we're eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received from Elohim the Father honor and glory. When there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory.
That's good enough right there. So we got John. It said that Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy. You see? Then we going on over to Peter, who walked with the Messiah, and what he said was that holy men of Yahweh spake and it was moved by the Holy Spirit. Now we're going to go and see what the Apostle Paul says. Let's read now. 13 and 1. Yes, please.
This is the third time I'm coming to you.
Read.
In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established.
Now Yahweh given us four to work with. Mm-hmm. All right? Let's read.
I told you before.
Read.
Before tell you as if I were present.
Read.
The second time, and being absent now, I write to them which heretofore have sinned and to all others.
Come on.
That if I come again, I will not spare.
Read on.
Seek ye proof, a proof of the Messiah speaking in me, which to you word is not weak, but is mighty in you. For though he was crucified through weakness,
read.
Yet he liveth by the power of Yahweh, for we also are weak in
him. Now let me say this. It says, although the Messiah was crucified through weakness. Well, let me translate that. Even though these folks may not have nothing in them to strengthen them. In other words, the Holy Spirit had not yet been poured out with. Wow. Yet. Wow. Therefore, they was weak through the flesh, but they because they were carnally minded. And Paul says to be carnally minded is death. In other words, these people, back under the dispensation of law, they were psychologically and spiritually weak because there was nothing in them, you see, to lead them in God whereby it was revealed to them at that particular time. Even though they desired it, You see, but they couldn't help themselves because there was nothing in them for them to see, because the only thing they saw was the flesh. The same thing that happened down here in the land of Egypt. Even though Pharaoh wanted to let the children of Israel go, but Yahweh said, I'm going to harden his heart. You see, even though he wanted to, he had no choice but to hold those people back, because Yahweh is carrying out his purpose to show his power over unrighteousness, and that is with Pharaoh. Let's read, please.
Well, examine.
And I'm going to say, we left off at that. Read that again. Before that.
For though he was crucified through weakness,
read.
Yet he lived by the power of Elohim.
Read.
For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of Yahweh within toward you.
Now slow this down right here. Come up. Read on.
Examine yourself.
Examine yourself. Read on.
Whether you be in the faith.
Come on.
Prove your own selves.
Read.
Know you not your own selves, that Yahshua the Messiah is in you, except you be reprobates?
And then we'll figure that out. Whether you be in the faith. You see? Either you in or you out.
All right.
Mm-hmm. You see? Your actions and your manifestations demonstrate whether you in or you out. You see, otherwise you'd be reprobate. In other words, you lack principles. You see, foundation. You see, and what we want to do is make sure in this school we give you a solid foundation of Yahweh's divine purpose and his pattern and his plan of salvation, so that you can stand the wild, that we stand the wiles of the adversary. And I'm letting you know, he's walking around every day with you, buffeting you. You see, about this and about that. You know, we're going to move you from one direction to the other direction. But what you want to do is keep your eyes stayed on Yahshua Messiah. Now,
the armor.
2 Corinthians, I think I'm what? I mean, 1 Timothy. I think I'm what? 2 Corinthians 3:16. I think that's what I want. 2 Corinthians, not Corinthians, but 2 Timothy 3:16.
Yeah. All the scripture that is given by inspiration of Yahweh.
Now hold it. It says what?
All the scripture.
All scripture.
That is given by
inspiration of Yahweh. Read on.
Is profitable.
Is profitable. Read.
For doctrine.
For doctrine. Wait a minute. What does the word doctrine mean? It is a body of principles.
That's right.
Matter of fact, I'll just take those two charts right on down the end. One and two. And just sit them right here. Please. See, let me say this while we're here. See, this is plate one, this is plate two. You see? And what it's showing forth is Yahweh Elohim, who is the supernal nature, being the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then, this is theosophy, you see, which is to study divine wisdom. And you have these attributes that are arranged, you see, in a certain position. And in reality, this particular plate was first before this one here, in reality. Mm-hmm. You see, however, Yahweh revealed himself first to Moses by appearing as a man. He appeared to the founder as a man because, as the founder says, we would not appreciate the brightness of his wisdom if we saw these attributes.
That's right.
You see, what we want to do, you see, we want to put this carnality, you see, this patchwork of a man to death. You see, so we're showing you the shape and form of a man, which is an anthropomorphic being. You see,
that's right.
With intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge being the crown. You see,
right.
Beauty, love, and justice, foundation, power, and strength, making up the body. You see, this is Yahweh Elohim in an organized shape and form. But these attributes was there already. This is the manifestation, you see, of these invisible principles, yet they're both invisible. In other words, this here is angelic invisibility. This is angelic visibility. Mm-hmm. Can only be seen in vision and revelation, but you ain't gonna never in your lifetime see intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength with your natural senses. It was just not set up that way. However, it is
the intelligence, the wisdom, the knowledge, the beauty, the love, the justice, the foundation, the power, the strength, or the attributes is going to be able to see you as you really are and as you actually exist and convert your soul.
Right.
You see, that's what this thing is all about. But we're going to utilize the witnesses that Yahweh has given us to understand these basic principles. You with me so far? What last scripture I call?
It was 2 Timothy.
Keep reading.
Okay. For reproof.
For reproof. Go back and read it again.
All the scripture that is given by inspiration of Yahweh is profitable for doctrine,
mm-hmm.
for reproof,
mm-hmm.
for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of Yahweh may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Now this is the body of principles that we're talking about. That is the body of Yahshua Messiah. And when it says reproof, it don't mean to prove it again. It means to rebuke it. And we're going to rebuke whatever anyone says or what they're talking about by the scriptures. Alright? Now the question is, what scriptures was Paul talking about when he made that statement? Because it was Paul writing a letter to Timothy, you see, and he's saying all scripture is profitable for doctrine, for reproof. You see, now he couldn't talk about it. No, the one thing about Timothy, he already knew the scriptures. You see, matter of fact, let's pick it up. I think it's 1 Timothy 2:15. I think that's what I want right now.
1 Timothy 2:15.
2:15. Yes.
Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing.
Wait, that's not what I want.
Adam was not deceived.
I think it's 2 Timothy 2:15 is what I want. Where it says, study to show thyself approved. A worker that needed not.
Study to show thyself approved.
Where's that?
2 Timothy 2:15.
Okay.
Study to show thyself approved unto Yahweh, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Now this is what the Christians think when we read that.
Huh?
They think, oh, I gotta read, I gotta study, I gotta check out this and check out that. That's not what that's talking about. Mm-hmm. You see, it says study to show for this reason. Timothy already knew the scriptures. Pick it up the first chapter, about the 4th verse. See, Timothy knew the scriptures back and forth because he was trained and taught by his grandmother, you see, Eunice. And what happened, Paul had converted her. Let's read, please.
2 Timothy 1:4.
Please.
Greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee,
mm-hmm.
which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois.
In other words, greet him.
And thy mother Eunice.
Read.
And I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance.
That's good enough right there. Lord, my point is, he knew the scriptures because his mother and his grandmother taught him as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So now Paul says, study to show thyself approved. You see, and what we come to find out is not talking about studying the scriptures, it's talking about rightly dividing the ages and the dispensations. Because see, it wasn't until I come to this school, I found out what an age was.
Right.
And when I come to this school, I found out what a dispensation is. You see, now, an age is synonymous to the word world. A world is approximately 2,000 years. You see, and I found out that in this school that we have 7 ages. You follow me? We also have 7 dispensations. We have a creative age, you see, which you read about as Moses is called up into this mountain here, and you see the creation, how it came in by the pattern. You see? And then you also see we have which ended up with the fall of Adam. You see, and in this age, you notice there is no time. You see, but in this age, which is the antediluvian age, starting from the fall of Adam, you see, which is a short age, which lasted for 1656 years, which ended at the flood, you see, this is the antediluvian age, or the age before the flood. The word diluvian is flood. Then you got the age after the flood, which is the post-diluvian age, which ended at the cross. So from the fall of Adam all the way down, you see, to the cross, is 4,000 years. You see, now what we have to understand also is that it was Yahshua Messiah who was born under the law. He also redeemed under the law, and he fulfilled those things under the dispensation of the law. Let's pick that up real quick, Galatians 4:4. Because see, the myth is that Christianity came in, or Jesus came in to set up a Christian way of life.
No way.
He did not come in to do that. He came in to fulfill the law and the prophets and to usher in grace, not to set up a Christian way of life on earth. That's what's taught. That is myth. You see, but let's read on.
Galatians 4 and 4.
Read.
When the fullness of the time was come, Elohim sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons.
That's good enough right there. In other words, the Messiah was born under the law, and he redeemed under the law. You see, his death, his burial, you see, and his resurrection was under the dispensation of the law. You see, it was not to the day of Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you see, when grace was ushered in, when the change took place. Whereas now, we are in under the age of grace. You see, and this is a spiritual dispensation, not a physical dispensation.
Right.
And I'll say this, and we can argue about it another time. There is nothing physical in this age, although it appears to be.
Right.
All right? What you're looking at is a reflect, you see, and that's all it is. But this is a spiritual dispensation. And I'll say this, and we can move on. We can talk about it some other time. Folks are looking for the end of the age to come, or the world to come to an end. This is my question to you. Why are you looking for a physical end in a spiritual dispensation?
Well, that's a good one. Very nice.
Now, we can talk about that another day. I'm just laying a brief foundation, you see, showing forth that Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy, and that Yahweh has given us witness to use and tools to use to come to a profound understanding of who he is. And I want you to understand that you are what you've been looking for. Now, I talked about what Paul John said over the book of Revelation. I talked about Peter, who walked around with the Messiah for 3.5 years, you see, as an apostle. And then we talked about the witnesses that Paul talked about, right? Now, this is what our founder said right here in this age. He's not saying anything different. Let me have his textbook. Okay? Go to page 5. Okay? Let's start the first, where it says basic scientific. Okay? Scriptural preparation. I think that's what it says.
Volume 1, page 5. Basic scriptural and scientific preparation.
Okay, go ahead. Let's read on.
This divine revelation of vision, pictorially illustrated and explained herein, was shown to the writer by a great panoramic vision.
Let's hold it right there, please. We have that illustrated all around this room for you to look at. Mm-hmm. You see, and it magnified for you to look at. All right? Now, I know I want to make sure we understand. See, this ain't no fly-by-night organization. Pick up real quick 1 Timothy, I think I want 1 and 14. Just as the founder painted charts, it's nothing new. The apostle Paul, he also used charts as well.
Right.
You see?
Yeah.
Then I come here and find out he called them parchments.
Yeah, right.
Okay? Because when he walked around teaching, he used charts just like the founder is using charts. Mm-hmm. And then I want you to continue on after that. Okay?
1 Timothy 1:14. And the grace of our Elohim was exceeding abundant with faith and love which is in Yahshua the Messiah. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all.
It might be 13. 1:13.
1:13.
I think it's 13.
Who was before a blasphemer and a prosecutor?
It must be 2 Timothy 1:14. It says, bring the parchments when you come. Mm-hmm. That's what it says.
It's not that.
1 14. That good thing which was committed unto thee.
Is that thing called parchments?
Alright, I'll find it for you. Second Timothy, I apologize, 4 and 13.
4:13,
yeah.
4:13.
Yeah, 2 Timothy 4:13.
with Carpus when thou comest, bring with thee and the books, but especially the parchments.
That's good enough right there. I want you to see that Paul used books and parchments just as we're doing today.
That's right.
And the founder said this, I'm not teaching anything different than what the apostles preached on the day of Pentecost. Mm-hmm. All right? Yeah, that's good enough. Let's head back to the textbook where you left off, please.
This divine revelation of vision, pictorially illustrated and explained herein,
read,
was shown to the writer by a great panoramic vision which embraces the existence of the eternal Yahweh Elohim, his universal spirit, law, and purpose,
now hold
dispensations
it.
And ages.
Okay. Read that one more time, but slow down, please.
This divine vision and revelation, pictorially illustrated and explained herein, was shown to the writer by a great panoramic vision.
That's the word I want to use. I want to draw this out a little bit. The founder said he had a panoramic vision.
Right.
I'll come here and find out what the word panoramic means. It means seeing from all directions.
Yeah.
You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
And then, what made his vision so great and so profound is that his vision, you guys want to teach up here? I don't let y'all come up here. Y'all distracted me.
The microphones are on when y'all talk.
All right? Thank you. What encompassed his vision? The founder's vision encompassed John's vision. You see, he too had a panoramic vision.
Right.
It's a sad thing. There's people in the school that does not know that John had a panoramic vision.
Okay.
There's folks in the school to this day do not realize that Moses had a panoramic vision.
Right, right.
And they've been looking at the chart for I don't know how many years.
That's right.
And don't realize, and they'll say, well, only the founder had a panoramic. No, they all did. Yeah. He had one, talking about John, had a panoramic vision of Elohim to Moses. And last week I validated visions, right? You see?
Right.
And then it says here, even Moses had a panoramic vision of Elohim to Moses. So, but he saw from the beginning to the end, and John saw from the end all the way back to the beginning.
Yeah.
Then you always get some little smart boy. You know what he says? Well, if John saw it, why didn't he write about the Genesis? Sound like a legitimate question, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. He was going to write it. Mm-hmm. Yahweh told him not to write it. Revelations 10 and 4. Pick it up real quick. I just want to make that witness, and then I want to move. Mm-hmm. Revelations 10 and 4.
Revelations 10 and 4.
Mm-hmm.
I'm with the seven.
And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I
what
was about to write.
What are the seven thunders?
Mm-hmm. Right.
What are the seven thunders? Mm-hmm. Well, we got it right up there on the chart. You see those lips right there?
Right.
You see? They're nice. I'm not, looks like female lips, but the point is, it's a nice set of lips. That's the point. That's the point I'm trying to make. The point is, Yahweh spoke,
yeah,
right?
Right, yeah.
And then you see the thunder right here, right? The lightning?
Mm-hmm.
You see, because first there's lightning, right? Then there's thunder, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got to have the voice, the sound, and then you have to have the sign to follow. So you got the lightning and the thundering, you see, and these are the seven thunders, you see. But see, Yahweh, Elohim himself, remember this, Yahweh transmuted into the first day, the second day, the third day, the fourth day, the fifth day, the sixth day, and then he entered into his rest.
Yeah.
And it wasn't seven thunders, as one would think, like said, in other words, it was Yahweh manifesting seven times. First day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, and the seventh day.
Okay.
It'd be the same thing if I come to your house and I take a snapshot
right
in the living room and I put it right there. And that's me in your living room. Then I walk into your kitchen, I take another snapshot with the Polaroid and I put it right there on the second day. So here I am in your family room, in your kitchen. Then I'm into your you get my point?
Right.
I do that several times in your bedroom, in your bathroom. So here I am, the same Joe, Right. Manifested on seven different days.
Right.
So here Yahweh Elohim revealing himself to Moses on six different days and then entered his rest. Those are the seven thunders. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please, now.
I was about to write.
What? About the seven thunders. Read on.
And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me,
read.
Seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered,
mm-hmm.
and write them not.
Don't rhyme at all. Why? Because Moses already wrote it. It makes sense to write it again.
That's right.
You see, now that's what he's talking about.
Thank
now
you.
Let's head back to the textbook.
Which embraces the existence of the eternal Yahweh Elohim.
Read.
His universal spirit law.
Read.
And purpose through the dispensation and ages.
Read on.
Comparatively speaking.
Read.
This is a new and revolutionary spiritual teaching.
In other words, it's not like everything else. This teaching is supposed to revolutionize your thinking. You see?
Right.
The way you process information. You see? And I'm going to tell you why before we go on. Pick up real quick while you hold it there. Romans 8 and 6. See, it's important that we understand that Yahweh gave us witnesses. And we understand when Yahweh gave us witnesses, it's going to lead us up to the Messiah. Because what I don't want to do is poo-poo the Messiah and act like he's not real and he's not genuine. You got that? Let's read it, please.
Romans 8 and 6.
Now, this is the Apostle Paul, and he is speaking in this present kingdom age. And this is what he says. Read.
For to be carnally minded is death.
Now, to be carnally minded is death. What does that mean? What it means is this. You see, this is what we call the map chart. Sometimes we call it the Daniel chart. Proving the existence and destruction of Satan and his angels through the dispensations and ages. I'm not going to draw this out, but this is a whole nice little lecture right here by itself. But that's what this chart is saying. And we're showing forth how that Yahweh himself, he is the generator. Meaning that he is the source and substance of all things. He's the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, the bounds, the origin, and the essence of all things. And everything that you see and you don't see, listen, is one another expression or manifestation of Yahweh himself. Yah being master, way being feminine. That makes Yahweh the parent substance. Therefore, everything you see, it emanates from him. You see, it has its source, its start place, its beginning with him. You see, but when he sets his purpose in motion, talking about Yahweh himself, and it was declared in the realm of eternity. You see, it was Yahweh, or the nephew, that took on an organized shape or form as Elohim, you see, the great anthropomorphic being, which is Elohim, or Yahweh Elohim,
right. The
archetype, or the original pattern of the universe. You see, and when you see him, all he did was appear within the cloud. And when you see him appear within the cloud, he's coming from behind the veil of inscrutability. And when you see him, he is an execution of the purpose or a declaration of the purpose. Why? Because Yahweh declared and purpose in the realm of eternity what shall be. So when he takes on shape and form, that is an execution of what he declared or a declaration of what he declared. Carry out the will of the Father according to the dictates and what was purpose back here in the realm of eternity. So now that he got the creation set up, or he himself set up, now he has to manifest that, or he manifests as, listen, the light, the darkness, you see, the waters, you see, above and the waters beneath, you see, the vegetation, the sun, moon, and stars, and the season, the animals, you see, and of course, the man himself. So he's cloaked in a veil, which leads Paul to say, to be carnally minded is death.
Right.
To be carnally minded is death. In other words, if you think, and I'll say it this way, he's the generator. So when he brings Adam in and forms him from the dust of the earth, you see, Adam himself is the degeneration. The degenerator. Now listen, Adam is Yahweh made manifest. What do you mean by that? Yahweh, who is spirit, took on an organized shape and form and manifested as the entire creation. He formed the man from the dust of the earth because he is a type of spirit. And then Yahweh himself, just took up residence in Adam, you see, and walked around in his own creation. It ain't another, but it's the Father himself or the Boss himself taking on shape or form in the man, walk around in his own creation, carrying out his own will.
That's right.
You with me so far?
Yeah.
So therefore, that would make Adam the degenerator.
Yeah.
He's bringing the purpose down by having. Mm-hmm. Now, in that he is a degenerator, because he's the first man or the first Adam, then it takes Yahshua Messiah, who is, you see, the second Adam. He is the regenerator. In other words, it is him that's going to redeem the man. Because we all died in Adam,
right.
You see, but first we lived in Adam. Mm. You see, but we did not know we lived in Adam, neither did we know we died in Adam. And that we did die in Adam, you see, Yahweh hid himself in Adam, just like Yahweh hides himself in you.
Yeah.
Somebody say, what do you mean by that? You think that you're Joe Williams. The hell with Joe.
Right.
And what he thinks and what he feels. Joe has to die. In order for Joe Williams to die, he has to put on Yahshua Messiah and realize that he is Yahshua Messiah and that he is Yahweh. And when he realized that, then he's in the Messiah who's walking, look, not after the flesh, but after the spirit. So therefore, when Adam comes in, and as he protects that fruit, keep this in mind. He's psychologically and spiritually dead. In other words, he died from the state that he was in.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Do you understand what I'm saying? And he's coming on down. And now, as we come in, we come in the same way he come in. So now we're becoming this patchwork of a man, if you will. You see, we get a little bit from our parents, our mother, our father, our siblings, our priests, our rabbis, our teachers, our coaches, our friends, the television, I'm talking about the commercials, all the TV shows, the soap operas, and all the movies, the world itself, going out experiencing nature, whatever you do, whether you play an instrument, you see, whatever profession you're in, or whatever experience you come in, I'm letting you know that becomes you. What are you talking about? That is the way of the world. It ain't got nothing to do with Yahweh as far as you're concerned.
Right.
And we're chasing wealth. You see, translation, greed. You see, and at the end of the day, ask Steve Jobs. But all the $1 billion, he couldn't save himself, could he?
Right.
It ain't about the money, but we are out here chasing wealth. It's not about that. It's about love. It's about giving.
Right.
It's about sharing.
That's right.
Of you,
that's
yourself.
Right.
That's difficult to do because we always worry about me and our image.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to give up your image because, see, this is our image. This is the image that we've embraced. And we want to hold on to our image and the way people look at us is what we want to hold on to. But through Yahshua Messiah, I'm letting you know, he don't care about your image at all. What he does, he destroys the kingdom of Satan. That was his kingdom of Satan abolished. Because see, what's keeping you from seeing who Yahweh is your image.
Right.
You see, the type of clothes you wear. You see, the church you go to.
Right.
That kind of thing. But the reality is, it's all about knowing him as he really is and as he actually exists. And I'm talking about Yahweh himself. So therefore, when he gets on this cross, he abolished death. And I'm talking about the physical death that we have fear of. You see, because the second death should not have no dominion over us. That is, if Joe Williams died. You see, and when he is dead, he no longer exists because now he is the manifestation of Yahweh. In other words, he's Joe Williams in a person. He's Yahweh in the personality of Joe Williams. You see, and it's him who has appeared to be. My mother's name is Alfreda Harris, and my father's name is Joe Williams. I'm their parents, but in reality, our true parents is Yahweh Elohim himself. That's hard to see because we're looking at something physical. Because our parents, we were just, they're just an ark. Just like Mary was an ark, carrying us. And see, when Yahweh separated the man from the woman, from the man from the woman,
right.
You see, in this plate over here, you see, oh, there's so much. You see, this heart his heart.
Take your time.
This heart is Yahweh himself. That is Elohim. Mm-hmm. In the midst of the cloud. This shaping form in this heart is born in the same.
Yes.
In that Yahweh set up a whole creation, you're going to see his heart in each one of these days.
Right.
Showing forth that he himself, the man, is manifested in that on that day. Him first and the rest of creation makes up his body.
That's right.
That's why everything in each day must reflect him, that he is threefold. Mm-hmm. He's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. He's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an incorporeal state. Then he transformed into a tabernacle or a pattern for you, the man, to use and to see, to understand something about him. He is the Word, but this is a definition or an explanation of the Word. It is a pattern, and everything must reflect him. So therefore, when he formed the man, you see, each day you see that heart showing forth. You see, as a man manifested, you got seven along on one side reflecting the 7 days of creation. Then you got three on the other side showing forth the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He built the tabernacle, or gave Moses the divine specification on how to construct the tabernacle. And he got the table of stones in his hands. And you see the laws written three on one side and seven on the other side. You see, to show him, the witness, that he himself, talking about Yahweh on him, he is that witness, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and then he sees this creation come in 7 days.
Right.
So when he constructs a tabernacle, it has to be threefold. A most holy place, a holy place, and a court around about.
Right.
Showing forth that he's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But this tabernacle has seven steps to it to reflect that it is him. So when he formed the man on the sixth day, you see, from the dust of the earth. You see, he is a photostatic copy of Yahweh Elohim himself.
Mm-hmm.
And when you see the man, you see, on the sixth day, you see, the woman is encountered within the man. You don't see a female there. You see, and when you see Yahweh Elohim appear within the cloud, you see, he is both masculine and feminine within himself. Why? Because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. So when he brings the man out, you see, and he's both masculine and feminine within himself, he has equipped to give birth to the woman. Why? Because Yahweh was master within himself, and he's equipped to give birth to Yahweh Elohim himself, which is his son. And then Yahweh Elohim is equipped to give birth to Virgin Mother Earth. So in that, he brings the man Adam in. This is the original archetype pattern of the universe. Adam is the first physical archetype man on the earth. Therefore, you see, he's equipped to give birth to the woman. In plain cornbread terminology, Adam had a womb. But then you see in this place, you don't see no heart up there. Am I right? You don't see no heart there. And the reason why you don't see no heart there is because now the purpose is getting ready to start coming down. You see, and he sprayed the woman out. You see, and now they two must come together, you see, to be Yahweh to give birth to a offspring. That's why we have this chart up here to show you that. See, we call this chart the philoprogenitiveness chart, which simply means the distinctive love of one's offspring. You see, and just as Adam had love for his offspring, we have love for our offspring. You follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And just as Adam laid down his life for his bride, you see, or his offspring, should I say, then likewise, you're going to lay down your life for your offspring. You with me so far? That is, if you be in the Messiah. Now, keep reading. I want to hear you finish this up. I want you to hold real quickly Acts 17 and 22.
Are you reading from Romans or textbook?
I'm done. Textbook.
Okay.
I didn't want to make my point about the carnal mind is death. Okay?
Which embraces the fields.
Pick up the thought, please.
Okay.
Just a previous sentence.
Comparatively speaking, this is a new and revolutionary spiritual teaching which embraces the fields of cosmogony,
mm-hmm.
anatomy.
Uh-huh.
Physiology.
Read on.
Physiology. Philosophy.
Philosophy.
Philosophy. Yeah. General science.
Uh-huh.
And eschatology.
Uh-huh.
to mention only a few things.
Read on.
This teaching is spiritually transforming.
It's spiritually transforming when you understand it. All right, let's read, please.
The carnal mind.
Read on.
And illuminate.
Now listen, it says it's spiritually transforming the carnal mind. In other words, Yahweh already knows that you're born psychologically and spiritually dead. And that when you get here, you have a dead, sick soul. What does that mean? You don't know Yahweh. You don't know the soul, the spirit, where you are, where you're going, even what you're doing here. That's what makes you psychologically and spiritually dead. It don't make you a devil. But it makes you set up to be tossed to and fro with every wind and doctor. Oh, this sounds good. Oh, this sounds good. Next thing you know, you're a Muslim. You see, next thing you know, you're a Christian. Next thing you know, you're Seventh-day Adventist. You're Jehovah's Witness. Because it all sounds good. And it says, well, you need something deep. If you utilize the pattern, I guarantee you won't need nothing deeper than that, because the pattern is so doggone simple, even a kid can understand it. But let's read on, please.
The understanding of mankind in regards to this, to his theological and religious concept of Yahweh Elohim and his purpose.
Read on.
It teaches mankind, according to the scriptures, the truth about his original, his origin.
Hold it. It says, read that one more time, because I want to make a point about the scriptures. Read on.
It teaches mankind, according to the scriptures.
Hold it. That's why I went this way, because the scriptures, as it was brought out about a few months ago, Moses will save your life. All you got to do is go back and review the record. When you review the record, what Moses does is, see, he leads you up to the Messiah. And when you come to the Messiah, you see, that is our hope. You see, the aim is this, to inherit your life now, not later on.
Right.
You see, in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah, which exists right now, with the hope of the more glorification, so that you might see it, and that your body, not this physical body, might be glorified, but your spirit man might be glorified in Yahshua Messiah. You got to discern the bodies. Let's read now, please, back in the textbook.
It teaches mankind, according to the scriptures, the truth about his origin.
His beginning. His start place. We talked about it. Let's read.
And his inseparable.
His inseparable. Read on.
Relationship.
Read on. We have an inseparable relationship with Yahweh. It's not a you and a Yahweh as we think.
No.
Oh, Yahweh said, Yahweh's in me.
24/7.
You are what you're looking for. You are Yahweh made manifest. You see? And I'm going to say this, and I'm going to sit down in a second. Real quickly, pick up 1 Corinthians, 3 and 16.
1 Corinthians 3 and 16.
Hold it. I want 3 and 16. Okay. And then I want Ephesians 4:4. And we'll go from there. I have two more, but I don't want to give you too many. Which one you want here? Just start with those two right there. Read first. The one I call first.
1 Corinthians 3:16.
Now here's Paul. This is what he says. Talking about you. Read.
Know ye not.
Don't you know? Do you know this? Don't you know it? Let's read.
That you are the temple of Yahweh.
That what?
That you are the temple.
That you are the temple of Yahweh. Read on.
And that the spirit of Yahweh.
And that the spirit of Yahweh dwelleth in you. Do you know that?
Right.
Come on, read on.
If any man defile the temple of Yahweh.
Now you know what? That ain't got nothing to do with no drinking and smoking. Right. That's what some folks think. I'm destroying the body. You know how you defile the temple of Yahweh? When you corrupt. When you corrupt, when you pervert intelligence. When you corrupt love. You see, in other words, when you tell somebody I love you, you know damn well you don't. Mm-hmm. You get my point?
Mm-hmm. Lie.
Very well said. She said it, but it's true. Lie. See, in order for a lie to exist, the truth has to be established. Am I right?
Right.
Because that's what happened in the garden. Right. See, Eve thought she was going to become something she already was. She thought that if she partook of the fruit, that she would get wisdom. Well, wisdom is part of her makeup. Because he told her that if you partake of the fruit, you'd be wise as Elohim. Well, wisdom was part of her makeup. So therefore, she thought she going to become something she already was. That was a deception. Not the doggone fruit that she ate it. You see,
right.
with eating the fruit was a manifestation that she was a seed. Hoodwink.
Right.
You see, Adam didn't touch the fruit, neither did he go near it. Why? Because he knew he wasn't going to become wise. That was Yahweh made manifest. But when she was drawn out, there's another little subject. the woman or the man, she was subject to vanity. That's why we acted there, fool. Because we too are subject to vanity. Why? Because we're not in Yahshua Messiah. But when she was in him, she was safe.
Right.
Come on, folks. You know when the kids here, they ain't got to go to a grocery store to get a little food.
Right.
When they have in here.
Right, right.
You see? Well, look, they get all, and listen, they don't give a damn if you starve about the woman. They don't give a damn if she starved. They're going to get their food.
Right.
I'm talking about the kids. The kids in the womb, they gonna rob you dry. They gonna take all your blood. You can be an idiot, but I ain't gonna be. You know what I'm saying? They gonna just rob you and eat all they can. And when they get here, guess what? They just as greedy they was in the womb as they are out the womb. You see? But let's move on, because I gotta sit down. Read on, please. Come on.
Oh, if any man defile the temple of Yahweh,
read on.
Him so Yahweh destroy. For the temple of Yahweh is holy. Which temple you are?
Which temple you are?
Right.
What you got?
Ephesians 4:4.
Let's read.
There is one body.
There is one body, that's Yahweh Elohim.
And one spirit.
And one spirit.
Even as ye are called in one hope.
Read on.
Calling.
Read on.
One element.
One element.
One faith.
One faith.
One immersion.
One baptism or one immersion. Read on.
One is Yahweh.
Ain't no two, three Yahwehs. Read on.
And Father of all.
Father of all.
Who is above all.
Who is above all.
And through all.
And through all.
And in you.
And in you all. And let me say this, Doc, to get rid of that carnality. He ain't talking about the sun, moon, and the moon, sun, moon, and stars. You know all these ball players, they got this fame. Soon they make a touchdown. You know what they do?
Yeah.
Oh, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? I can draw this thing out about the genuflection and all that kind of stuff. You know what this is all about? Hey, he said thank you, but you know what? It's about his image.
Yeah.
You know, trying to look all holy and pious. That's really what it's about, because you don't do it no other time.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Right. Right.
But when everybody's looking at you, guess what? I'm holy and pious. I'm giving all my praise to God.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I ain't got time. But the book says, over there, he talks about that in Colossians, you can't worship Yahweh with men's hands.
That's right.
17th
chapter.
You see, 14th chapter, right?
2.
17. Is it 17?
22 where you were going.
Oh, okay. I see you're right. You're right about that. You see, now, I think I made my point. Because I got to get out. I call it another scripture, did I not?
No.
Okay, then that's why I'm going to go to Acts 17 and 22. Then I'm going to sit down. Read on down. Now, here's the Apostle Paul. You see, here he is in the age where we sit in the present kingdom age. Oh, man, the gospel's good when you understand it.
Man.
I kid you not. It just nourishes you and gives you strength. You see, now here's Apostle Paul. You see, he's going to Athens, Greece. And he's walking around like we go to a museum. And he's checking out all these statues and all. I mean, because these people study. I ain't got time to draw it out. They study. And they're checking out. Paul checking out all these doggone statues. I'm talking about, you know, like Greek mythology and all these gods they got. You know, and he's just walking around. And then he comes across one that says, to the unknown. Paul said, let me talk about him. Because just in case we miss one, guess what? Let me let you talk about him. Let's read.
Acts
17 to 22. Read on.
Then Saul stood in the midst of Mars.
In Mars Hills. Come on, read.
And said,
read.
Ye men of Athens.
He said, you men of Athens. In other words, he didn't say what he really wanted to say. You carnal-minded generation of vipers.
Right.
You see, you whitewall sepulchers.
Exactly.
You follow me? You don't get me started. Let's read. Right. Come on.
I perceive that in
all things. He said, I perceive and I understand what?
All things.
All things.
Read on.
Ye are devoted to the worship of idols.
This ain't gonna get you nowhere. Let's read. Come on.
For as I passed by.
As I passed by and see all your idols. Read on.
And beheld your object
of
worship.
Come on.
I found an altar with this inscription.
Hey, what does it say?
To the unknown.
That's Yahweh.
That's right.
You see, the source of something. Let's read, please.
Whom therefore ye
ignorantly crucify me, worship. In other words, you think that you're going to have salvation in this too.
Mm-hmm.
You see, let's read, please.
Him declare,
this is what I'm going to declare unto you. Come on, read.
Yahweh who made the world.
Yes, Yahweh who is source, substance. Read, please.
And all things therein.
And all things therein, including you. Let's read.
Seeing that he is ruler of heaven.
He is ruler. Heaven and earth. Come on, let's read.
He dwelleth not in temple.
He dwelleth in temple, not in what made your hands, right?
Yep, right.
Y'all don't look like no doggone. Y'all was made with hands. I don't see nobody up in here made with hands. He dwelleth in temple, not way made with hands. Because it is him that's in you. Let's read. Come on.
Neither is worship.
Read.
That's him.
Hey. I ain't 25 no more. I can't get down there. And pop back up like I used to, because I feel a little squeak. in my knees, but y'all get the point.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? All this stuff, down and up and all, you know what I mean? For what? But read on, please. Thank
as
you.
As though he needed anything.
As though he needed, like he needed your doggone praise and all this stuff. That's for the people, ain't for y'all, because y'all, we already know what's in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
See, he giveth to all life.
Come on.
And breathe.
Read.
And all
come
things.
On. We gotta go. Read on.
And hath made of one man all nations.
He made of one man all nations. That is Adam. We all within his laws. Come on.
For to dwell on the face of all the face of the earth.
Come on, read.
And hath determined the times before appointed.
Read on.
And the bounds of their
oh, there's so much in there. Come on, read, please.
That they should seek him.
Read.
If haply they might feel
come
after
on.
Him.
Come on, read on.
And find him.
And find come on, read.
If he be not far from every one.
Hey, he's right up in here. He's right in you. That's who you are. Let's read.
For in him we live.
For in Yahweh we live. Read on.
And move.
And we move.
And have our
beings. And we have our beings in Yahweh. Read on.
As some of your own poets.
Come on, read on.
For we are also his offspring.
We are also his offspring. That's good enough right there. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Next
one.
Our next speaker this afternoon will be Dr. Will Wheaton. Got a problem with that?
Not at all.
You wouldn't like that. You do it every time.
Oh my God.
So why are you tripping on that, Red? I feel you.
No, you don't.
You'd be surprised.
It was you.
Let's move on. Let's move on.
Can we get along?
At the moment, let us feel Yahweh.
That's right. I know what's happening.
You can't speak to nobody.
Well, can we allow Yahweh to speak for a moment?
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Want to speak to me.
That's all I always thought. Okay. Uh-huh. Yeah, good seeing you, brother. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. I've been up all morning. Good night. I appreciate the first speaker, and he went through a lot of things.
Yeah.
I could spring off of him. Just trying to feel, you know, what I should go into. In our workshop, we went through the tabernacle. We was talking about the Day of Atonement, mm-hmm. And like anything, when we study these charts, and these charts is just a visual representation of the divine vision, we're not trying to be. How can I put it? Dr. Kennedy said it best. This is not a scripture quoting contest.
Right.
No, neither.
I mean, you know, I know we read a lot of scriptures, but it's not about that. I mean, the Bible is the most widely read book on the planet. And people can quote scriptures from it all the time. I mean, you know, somebody quoted scripture on the president the other day, mm-hmm. You know, wanting him dead and whatnot. See, so the Bible is well known.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. That was Psalm 108:6 or something like that. Because they think he's the Antichrist. And so,
that's right.
You know, mm-hmm. So they use that scripture and the following scriptures to say, you know, that's their prayer, really. Mm-hmm. Oh, please, you know, let us all be healed. And then they want bad things to happen to his children and all that.
Yeah.
Really, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, that's just to show you how the mentality is. And these are the people that are voting for Trump.
Okay? Yeah.
All right. Now, I need an introduction. And let me say something at this point. I don't discourage questions, but at least allow me, or allow Yahweh, I put it like that, to answer your question before you voice it. Because mm-hmm. That will show his power. See, when you ask me the question, you're just trying to show my power. I'm not against questions. I mean, if Yahweh would so move you to raise your hand, raise your hand.
Mm-hmm.
I ain't got no problem with that. That's how I learned. When I came in here. In fact, that's how everybody did back in the day. You know, because people were competent enough that, you know, you can say anything like that, somebody raised their hand, you know, what you have to say, what you want? You know, they just ask and get answered. Because that's how I came into class. If I raised, you know, when he said you can raise your hand ask question, I was right there.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked the questions, you know, based on what I was hearing, I said, well, what about this? You know, and I guess like a baseball. So that's That's being an able-bodied minister. And that's what we try to impart by going through these lessons. See? Of going through the scriptures, the first speaker talked about it, the law and the prophets, being acquainted with that. And we tell you that. You know, at least read it. Don't try to wrestle with it or figure out, but at least be acquainted with the scriptures. Mm-hmm. And that's what these charts will help you to do. That's what the pattern will help you to do. Because the founder, when he received this vision, he was well acquainted with the scriptures. I mean, the guy was an assistant pastor for 15 years. Could quote, you know, a bibliomaniac by his account and others.
Right.
But when he received this vision and understanding of this pattern, this divine pattern, then the Bible, it just didn't read the same anymore. Mm-hmm. Because now he's looking at it through the eyes of the pattern. Mm-hmm. And that's what we want to do. See, we want to look at not just the purpose of Yahweh. I mean, the purpose of Yahweh through the eyes of the pattern as ascertained, illustrated on these visions. Yeah, on these charts, rather. Now let's get to our one. I think it's Hebrews 6:19. Because see, in the last workshop we kind of went through this, and I didn't really come to a conclusion. And it makes me feel bad when I don't do that. Because see, there's a scripture. What is that? And I think I think it's in Proverbs. It says, "Wisdom is the principal key."
Proverbs 4:7.
Yeah, Proverbs 4:7. Yeah, read that first before you read the. Yeah.
Proverbs 4:7.
Mm-hmm.
Wisdom is the principal thing.
Right, wisdom is the principal key. You know, as was pointed out. You know, it's one of the attributes of it's the crown. See, this is the great triad here: wisdom, intelligence, knowledge. It's a triad. Mm-hmm. And it's a wisdom is the principal key. Read.
Therefore, get wisdom.
Read.
And with all thy getting, get understanding.
But see, but in all thy getting, get an understanding. Yeah. That's the whole point of all this. Mm-hmm. Getting an understanding of everything that we're looking at, everything that we're going through.
Right.
Mm-hmm. One, they're all types and shadows. Mm-hmm. Once you recognize that, then we can, you know, take a step towards some sort of spiritual understanding of what we're looking at. Now, what Hebrews 6:19. Yeah.
Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul,
mm-hmm.
most sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Here the forerunner is for unto us. Is for us entered,
mm-hmm.
even Yahshua, made a high priest forever,
mm-hmm.
after the order of Melchizedek.
All right, now Yahshua is made a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Why is that? Because, one, he is the one of whom the promise was given, of us talking about when it was given to Abraham, that his seed would bless all the families of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that promise was confirmed by Melchizedek. Mm-hmm. 23. Since we already got two plates up here. And listen, the thing I have learned, you know, as about these plates. All of these plates are correlated.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. Once you understand. Here, this is a migratory pattern.
Mm.
This is the pattern of the tabernacle. There are seven correlations in between them. Why? Because there are seven steps,
mm-hmm.
in the pattern. So there are seven correlations between this plane and this plane. These are the prime correlations you need to know and understand to understand all of these planes. And listen, to understand these seven correlations, guess what? You're going to have to read Moses.
Mm-hmm. Right.
How else are you going to find out about the tabernacle except in what Moses wrote?
Mm-hmm.
How else are you going to know about the migratory pattern except in what Moses wrote? Did not Moses write the first five books of the Bible?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is where this information is at.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How are you going to know about Abraham and Melchizedek unless you read what Moses wrote?
Mm-hmm.
This is in the book of Genesis. Did not Moses write the book of Genesis?
Yes.
You understand my point? Mm-hmm. See, that's why you have to become more familiar with the stories. The more familiar you become with the stories, the more the pattern you'll see being made manifested in each of these events. And here's the byproduct of that. The more you do that and see that, the more you begin to see the pattern being made manifested in your life. Not that it wasn't manifest in the first place, but you'll see how it's made manifest. How your life is going. We could make a plate out of you.
Nice.
We could make a plate out of you. Matter of fact, we already got one. Yeah. Here you are.
Yeah.
With the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Also got another plate with you on it before the Holy Spirit. Want to know what you look like?
Yeah.
Here you are. So we got you.
Mm-hmm.
Coming and going.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See? Up and down.
Now here's the whole thing about this. In our workshop, we was going through the Day of Atonement. See, and when you break it down, atonement just simply means at one mint.
Yes.
Right.
To be at one. The first speaker alluded to it. He talked about Adam and Eve up here. How they were up in the garden. They were one at first. Because he made them male and female. He, them. Male and female, he, them. And they were one.
Right.
She was taken out of him. When she was taken out of the man, she became subject to vanity.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yep.
She became subject to vanity, thereby precipitating this transgression. Let's read that. Romans 8 and 20. I'm trying to make a proper introduction so that I can go through a body and come to a conclusion. Because you see, the whole idea, as far as the purpose of Yahweh is concerned, I can put it really succinctly. I could say this. The purpose of Yahweh is to bring all things back into himself.
Right.
Why? Well, all things came out from him. Okay?
Romans 8 and 20.
Please.
For the creature was made subject to vanity.
Uh-huh.
Not willingly.
Not willingly. Talking about Eve. Talking about the woman. She didn't have anything to do with her being taken out of Adam. That was Yahweh's doing. But Yahweh did that for a purpose. Because when he did that, see, that turned on, it was like flipping the switch, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yes.
Read.
Not willingly.
Not willingly.
But by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope.
Now listen, after the transgression, see, when a woman was taken out of the man, she was made subject to vanity. I'm pointing to Lucifer. This is the vanity that she was made subject to.
Very good. Mm-hmm.
See? That's why it was possible for him to deceive. I mean, plus also, I mean, he had great beauty and wisdom. I mean, much more than she did. I mean, he deceived her, really, with the truth. Because she didn't realize that she was, she was already that. Why? She already had wisdom, intelligence, she had intelligence. She had that. But see, but this is Yahweh's purpose doing this. See, where's that at? But keep reading. And I need Timothy, where it says, and Adam was first formed, and then the woman.
It was a shepherd. Timothy. I haven't seen that.
20, for the creature was made subject to vanity,
not willingly.
By the reason of him who had subjected the same in hope.
Now see, now after the transgression, she was made subject in hope. What do you mean? She was now made subject to her husband.
Mm-hmm.
Because when he was cast out, she followed him. She followed her hope.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Read.
Because the creature itself shall also be delivered from the bondage of corruption.
Because if she follows her hope, this creature, she will see, which is all of us really, because that's what she's representing. She's going to be saved from the bondage of corruption. What do you mean? The second Adam.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to be redeemed.
Right.
See? The second Adam.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Into the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together now.
It's the same way now spiritually speaking, because we're in a spiritual age. Mm-hmm. And see, and listen, we say it all the time. We have a immortal spirit dwelling in a physical body.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
In other words, we are pregnant.
Yeah. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And that will give birth without oh boy. I will have the time. Come on.
And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
Even we ourselves growing within ourselves.
Even we, I'm talking about right now as we walk around.
Right.
We groan within ourselves.
Right.
For something better. I mean, we got this, but even now we know. Because see, we're in a process. These ages.
Yeah.
See? We're in a process. Boy, keep reading quickly.
Waiting for the adoption to wit, the redemption of our body.
The adoption. That is to say this. We've got new wine and some old skins.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's right.
Being white.
And it can't take it. Because it'll burst.
That's right.
Can't take it.
Right.
So we gotta change the container. For new wine, gotta get new skins.
We got Timothy.
Yes.
For Adam was first born.
Where yet?
Then 1 Timothy 2:13.
Okay.
For Adam was first born.
Mm-hmm.
Then Eve.
Uh-huh.
And Adam was not deceived.
Now Adam was not deceived. See, people forget that. See. Yeah, because they always concentrate on Eve. Well, she was deceived, and Adam, it makes it seem like she tricked Adam, because then she gave it to the fruit to him, and he ate it, and, so it cast bad light on the woman.
Mm-hmm.
But he was not deceived. Here's the illustration. We got it over here. We got it right here. Look at it. See here?
He didn't die.
Now here they are, carrying on. Look at him. He's sitting over here watching this. Watching her. See, watching the tree. See, he's not seeing it. He's not seeing because this is a vision to her. He Adam ain't seeing. Listen, he's watching her watching the tree.
All right.
And he's like, okay, woman, what are you doing? And then she reaches and it was an olive. And she reaches up and she plucks the olive off. And he's like, oh man.
In
okay,
in
well. Okay.
I did it.
I know what's coming now.
And then
she plucks it, she turns around and she walks on it and she offers it to her. He could have just said,
nah.
You know you're wrong with it. I mean, you know what I'm saying? But because he had love.
Right.
He said, well, yeah, it's just like, you know, like only you. He said, hey, you know, like, I'll take the rap for you, you know. What was that movie? It was not a movie I saw. No, it was a TV show. It was that TV show, Underground, about the slavery. It was like this little slave boy, he did something, and this guy was in a carriage, and, you know, it was a white guy, but you know, one of the overseers, the white overseer. And he was really mad. He was going to whoop. I mean, he was a little 5-year-old, but he was going to, with a car, he was going to work. But so his older sister came out and said, I'll take the lashing for him. And so she bared her arms and took the lashings for him.
Right, right.
See, you understand?
Yeah.
She took responsibility. He was at fault, and he was wrong. But she knew he couldn't bear that punishment.
Mm-hmm.
So she took it for him.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Thank you.
He took it for her. She couldn't bear this, so he took it for her.
Mm-hmm.
That's why she was made subject. She was made subject to vanity.
Mm-hmm.
Now she's made subject in hope.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Very good.
Because Adam is the second subject to hope. Subject to hope.
Yeah.
Okay, because this Adam, I'm talking about Yahshua, he's the second Adam, he's fulfilling the first Adam, because he's picking up the first Adam when he fell. So if he's picking up the first Adam when he fell, and she is subjected to him in hope, then she's also subjected to him in hope. I mean, if he's picking up the first one where he fell.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's all. Okay, and you're talking, I'm Adam. For Adam Phil, that's all what I'm doing now. Here, let's take it. I'm Adam. Oh, okay. So she follows him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She follows him. Mm-hmm.
Very good.
Yeah. Perfect.
Turn on line.
Yeah.
See?
Uncle Eugene.
Subjected in hope.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, we can see that on that scale.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to have to see it according to, and I always give him credit because I stole it from him, this phrase. Now we're going to have to see it from the great panoramic viewpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Clarence
Martin. 38, 39, 40.
Okay.
The
playlist. Oh, yeah. 38, 39, 40.
It's hard to talk about the beginning, but I'll talk about the end. And see, and I forgot I got Abraham up here. Since I got him up here, here's Abraham being blessed by Melchizedek. All right, that seed is in him.
Right.
See, and he's being blessed by Melchizedek, king and high priest of Salem, and here's him offering the tenth portion of the spoils. You know, because he had to go do a rescue mission, defeating the five kings, and so he gave Melchizedek a tenth or a tithe of that. And Melchizedek blessed the seed in his womb, see, of which comes down and coming down through the veil here, pressed through his loins, that's the veil. Mm-hmm. And 40 weeks later, Sarah, you know, she is, you know, impregnated and she gives birth to Isaac. Okay? And Isaac is a type of Yahshua. He's a type of that promised seed.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay?
All right.
Now, did I ask for another scripture?
Mm-hmm. No, you just...
Okay, I was wondering if I had any scriptures holding. Okay, now.
I got a highlight, too much highlight. You need to close the door.
No, just down.
Yeah, I know that too, but...
Oh, okay.
It was just too much.
Yeah. Oh, all right, okay.
Okay.
Wow, can we do this?
Okay, that'll work.
Plague 31. And then I give it to some sort of explanation.
It's that vinyl.
Okay. Like 31. Acts 1 and 2. Yeah, how much time I got? Okay, now I gotta fly.
Acts 1 and 2. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Elohim.
Okay, now, this is 40 days later, after his, okay, this is death, burial, resurrection, okay, and then he comes out, quickening spirit, tarries on earth 40 days, and at the end of 40 days, he ascends. Mm-hmm. All right? Does anything else?
And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, you have heard of me.
Uh-huh.
For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence.
Mm-hmm.
Keep reading.
You tired?
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, You men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Yahshua which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven.
Okay, now, this is what the Christians read and interpret as Jesus going on a cloud and ascending up into the atmospheric heaven. First, first area is they think he resurrected physically, a physical body. And that then he physically got on a cloud and physically went up into the sky. Because the first speaker alluded to how people look up. Because most people have that idea of God as a sky above the sun and the stars. So everybody look down, I know you're looking down, I mean, that kind of stuff. So therefore Christianity believes the same thing, which is the rapture, saying that he's going to come back in like manner. You know, I don't know how that's going to be affected, because if he was to come down over Ontario, you sure wouldn't be able to see him in Moscow, Russia, because they would be at night.
Right.
You know, I doubt that you could see him up, as far away as Los Angeles. You know, you understand? So the thing about it is, we have to understand what are we really talking about here. Oh boy, how much time I got. 2 Corinthians 12:1, quickly. And you have to read a little faster, I think.
Second Corinthians 12:1. It is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh. I knew a man of the Messiah about 14 years ago. Mm-hmm. Whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. Uh-huh. Yahweh knoweth. Such an one caught up to the third heaven.
Third heaven, see. Read.
And knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell.
Uh-huh.
Yahweh knoweth. How that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words which is not lawful for a man to utter.
Okay, let's call him to the third heaven. Now, that would preclude that there's a first and a second heaven. See, most Christians don't even think about that. See, the first heaven is space.
Right.
See, and the earth hangs like a ball in space, and we got this court roundabout here painted black. In part because one of the plagues down here in Egypt was a plague of darkness. And space itself is black.
Yeah.
And the earth hangs like a ball in space. Then you have the atmospheric heaven, that'd be here in the holy place. Then you have Canaan's land would represent the third heaven or eternity, of which the first two heavens emanate from. Mm-hmm. Now you are body, soul, and spirit. Now, when I compare that, space, atmosphere, eternity. All right, space, atmosphere, eternity. Body, soul, spirit. All right, they're correlated. Okay, now, let's get. I think it's 1 Thessalonians 4:13.
1 Thessalonians 4:13. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope.
Mm-hmm.
For if we believe that Yahshua died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Yahshua will Yahweh bring with them. For this we say unto you by the word of Yahweh, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of Yahshua shall not prevent them which are asleep. For Yahshua himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of Yahweh, and the head and dead in the Messiah shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet Yahshua in the air, and so shall we be with him. Wherefore comfort one another with these words.
Now see, when Christianity reads that, they literally believe that, well, one, they believe that there'll be a physical resurrection at the end.
Right.
You know, all these people will come out of the graves, they said the graves will pop open, bodies will come on up. And then all of a sudden, Jesus is going to be, he's somewhere up here, he's floating up here somewhere, and they're all going to start rising up, floating up towards. Because the scripture said he caught in the air.
Yes.
And
what about the ones that are cremated? They have no bodies.
I don't know. You have to ask them about
that. That's a good one.
You have to ask them about. Well,
they don't want to be cremated.
Most people don't. They don't. Because most people don't. Well, most black folks don't. I'll tell you that. In the country of Greece, there are no crematoriums at all, and they have a problem as far as tombs. I mean, the problem over in Greece is so bad as far as graves. When you bury a relative, you literally have to rip the grave.
Right.
And if you can't, and the prices are so exorbitant over the years, they will come and say, well, if you can't pay it, well, I'm sorry, you know, you got to get these bones out.
Yeah.
And they'll put it, and if you maybe you can afford it, they'll put it in an ossuary.
Yeah.
And if you can't afford that, they got a big burial pit, they just throw it in there.
Yeah.
But you got to pay, I mean, you got a dead relative in here, and you pay a rent for him to lay up in.
Yeah.
I mean, for a dead body.
Wow.
But see, but a crematorium is outlawed because, for that reason.
Yeah.
Because, see, the Greek Orthodox Church, they believe, they said, wait a minute. And they had the guy on the decree, and he said, look, how can we ignore 2,000 years of tradition?
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because they believe in a bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that when he comes back, it's going to be a bodily resurrection of all. So if there's no body,
that's right.
How can we do?
What are you going to do? Yeah.
Right. That's what it is. That's what they believe. Because they believe in a physical, most of the world's religions believe in a physical resurrection or some type of physical paradise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses say, you know, we're going to, you know, tear up all the roads and stuff in the concrete, you know, and the whole planet will be a Garden of Eden worldwide, and we'll be walking around with white robes and that kind of thing. All the religions have very similar. The Jews believe in a physical resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
The Buddhists believe in one. The Muslims believe in one. The Hindus.
Mm-hmm.
The Egyptians.
All of them. They all believe in it.
All of the above.
See? Now, here's the thing we're talking about. So now, the first speaker said, there's no such thing. This, you know, how are you going to have a physical end to, you know, to a spiritual age? Well, see, the thing about it is, see, now when they do preach that, they do preach, you know, like a physical upheaval, the physical city coming down from the cloud. See, the end of this age is spiritual because
right.
It is a transmutation.
Yes.
Right.
It's a transmutation. See, look, we just showed you. See, here. Here's Yahshua. And see, he's appearing. See, look, I think the scripture was read. You had it read. There was an act about out of one man or one blood, all the nations of men dwell on the face of the earth. See, the whole human race is one flesh.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or one body. Dr. Kinley said this himself.
Yeah.
He said, we're all one flesh.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is we need to be of one spirit. But the whole human race is already of one flesh or one body because we all come from one man.
Right.
And that's the veil. If you were to take your body, I'm talking about the skin on your body, and without tearing it up, and just was able to take the skin off of your body just to see how big it is, would you believe, and this is on just about anybody, no matter how skinny or how fat you are, the average size, it would be a fabric 6 by 6 feet.
Right.
Mm-hmm. A veil.
Wrap around.
This is the veil. And see, by him coming through the veil, that's where he comes into a state of incorporeal visibility. That way he can appear to everyone in here.
Mm-hmm.
And see, and when he does appear here, we who are in Yahshua now, we appear with him.
Yeah.
Right.
Look. Plague 29 and 30. See, the high priest. See, look, I'm looking at this order because to get an understanding of the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe, which is what Elohim is officiating at, after the order of Melchizedek, 29. See, okay, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest, this was the only day he could go up here in the Most Holy Place.
That's right.
Okay, now when he went up here, he had to be specific, had to go up there with specific blood, a specific order, a specific course of action.
Okay.
He had three sacrifices. See, he had the sacrifice for the bullock.
Right.
They had to sacrifice a bullock. Now, what is a bullock? A bullock is simply a gelded book. I mean, it's a unit book. Thank you. That's what I'm going for. Castrated, that's what a bullock is. It's a castrated bull. And when a bull is castrated like that, it's a beast of burden. I mean, you can get a lot of work out of the bull, because if he's not, you know, you might get a little bit of work out of it, and then, you know, you might see a cow on the hill, and you know, get the thing to
sell
up. See? That'd
be a
unit bull.
But see,
but
yeah.
It'd be too weak.
Okay. Unit bull. But that's what it was. But that's what he was. I'm talking about the priest, because right. He was a beast of burden. I mean, he had to do a lot of this work. You know?
Yeah.
See over here. We got it illustrated over here. See, they had to look at this. See, they had to keep that fire. This was a continual fire. That had to be burning. This brazen lady had to be full. See, there were things that had to be done. See, there was continual sacrifices, right. You know. The high priest, you know, he had to officiate over these guys, you know, when they're killing the lamb. He's not staying, you know, while they're absolving, you know, all of that. I mean, it was a 20-year job, you know. Was it 20-year job. Yeah.
Can I say something? When a bull is castrated,
uh-huh.
He get bigger and stronger.
Right. Yeah. That's right. That's any male castration. Because uh-huh. See, like male eunuchs, that's why, you know, they have male eunuchs. Mm-hmm. They were bigger.
Yeah.
You know, to guard the harem. Oh. And at the same time, they wouldn't mess with the harem.
They ground.
Yeah. You know, being, you know, and they had a high pitched voice.
Yeah.
You know. Mm-hmm. Sadly, one guy was who had been castrated when he was a child. He was a brilliant scientist. And it blew me away when I first, because they had a recording of him, of his voice, and it blew me away when I heard him speak. And that was George Washington Carver. Oh. See, George Washington Carver had been born a slave.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had been kept, see, and he was like a playmate to the daughter of the people that owned it, you know. And so he was like a protector. And so to make sure that he wasn't doing it, they castrated him.
Hmm.
And see, and when he grew up, I mean, he was a brilliant scientist, but when you heard him talk, I mean, he had such a, I mean, he was a high-pitched voice, and then, I mean, his voice was higher pitched than Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
Because of his castration. And it blew me away, because I remember reading something about it obscure, but I didn't really know it was true or not until they had a footage of him, and they, you know, showed him talking, and I was like, oh my goodness, couldn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Thank
okay.
You.
So, where are we at here?
What? That was the first sacrifice.
Yeah, okay, here. Yeah. The first sacrifice, thank you. The bullock. So now, when he went up there, because see, that was always a question on how was he dressed when he went up there.
Right.
And then I used to always think he went up there, you know, with the, you know, garments of beauty, going, you know, each time and took it off and then came back. And see, the Jewish tradition is that he wore the garments of beauty and glory, talking about the breastplate, the woman, every day, which he did. Which he did. And that on the Day of Atonement, he would wear linen garments because it was a sign of humility. Mm-hmm. Going up, you know, approaching the throne of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Which I halfway agree. And here's why I only halfway agree. Because you see, on the second trip, on this, okay, now the first trip, he's going up there with the bullock.
Mm-hmm.
All right, he's wearing just plain linen garments.
Mm-hmm.
He goes up there. Now he's got to get coals
right.
from the incense,
right.
The altar of incense.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got a censer here, and he's got to go up behind the veil,
right.
And he's got the blood. He's got the censer on his arm, and he's got to flick blood toward the mercy seat 7 times and go around it. Now the mercy seat has got stains in it. See, he's got stains in it, so because he can't touch the mercy seat,
right.
So he's got to get between the stains, and he can't turn his back on the mercy seat either,
because
it's on a swivel,
right?
All right, just like your neck is on a swivel, all right. So now he's got to get between the stains, and he's flipping the blood, and he's turning the mercy seat around,
very good,
all right. And as he's turning around, the seventh flip, no, how does he go? I think it's going, that's right, yeah, that way. Yeah.
Number 8.
Yeah, because then once he does this, then he can back on out this way on this side of the veil. And then because he can't turn his back, so he got to turn back on out, and then he comes back, all right, comes back out, and then he comes back down here, and he gets the other blood. And he's still wearing white linen garments, and he goes, and see now, the second blood is from the goats. Now, there were two goats.
Right.
See, one goat was a scapegoat, by which they had to pray the sins over, and a fit man, a guy who was kind of hardy, you know, say, look, okay, take this goat, you take him out to the wilderness as far as you can, and you let him go out there, and you come back to us. Right? Now that's what the one goat, you know, for the scapegoat. Right. Now the other goat was for the sins of the children of Israel. That was sacrificed. The blood of that would have to be taken up. Same way. He's wearing linen garments, got to go up here, get coals off the incense, put it on this censer. He's got to come up from behind the veil and do the same thing again. Go around, flick the blood seven times, and go around, come back out. Alright? Censer down, then come back down and get the second blood. Now this time when he getting the third blood, this is the blood of the ram. And the ram's blood was for the cleansing of the sanctuary. Why? Because of the constant sacrifices that were made here. See, this sanctuary was defiled. Mm-hmm. So this had to be cleansed. And that was by the ram. Yes?
What was the purpose of the scapegoat?
The scapegoat, because if they let him get out of it, escape.
Take the sins out.
Yeah. See, the sins, and he escaped. Do nobody know what happened? Did he just escaped?
Yeah.
Even back more than likely. You know. See, but the thing is, see, he was taken outside the camp. Mm-hmm. See, mm-hmm. Just like Yahshua, see, when he was crucified, he was taken outside the city and died. Okay, everything. Look to Yahshua for everything in the fulfillment. If you have any question, well, why did they do this and such and such, and it's in the Old Testament, simply go to Yahshua and say, how did he fulfill it?
Right.
Because everything that's in the Old Testament is fulfilled by Yahshua. Mm-hmm. He's the one who's performing it some kind of way. See? Just like what I'm getting ready to say now as far as this ram's blood. See, here he's got to come up here, and this time when he comes up here to the altar of incense, he's got to put on the breastplate, the Urim and the Thummim, the ephod, and he's got to put that on, and then go up here, and then offer, you know, put coals on him, on the censer, same as, and then do the same thing. And then when he comes out this time, then he throws the censer down to the ground, and he says, "It is finished." Mm-hmm. Now. Here's the reason why I say that on the first two times he went up there with linen garments, and on the third time he went up there in the garments of beauty and glory. That's why I have these plates up here, because plate 29, plate 30, and plate 31 is representative of Moses' three trips into the mount.
Mm-hmm.
Plate 29 here, culminating with the Sermon on the Mount, this is a fulfillment of Moses' first trip into the mount. This is plate 30, miracles and fat and transfiguration, culminating with the Mount of Transfiguration, or Mount Tabor. This is a fulfillment of Moses' second trip into the mount.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection, and his ascension on the Mount of Olives. This is a fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mount. Okay? Now in saying that, and Yahshua's fulfilling, I can also say this. This is also a fulfillment, each of these trips into the mount, of the high priest.
Right.
Three trips into the most holy place on the Day of Atonement.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And how he was dressed. How so? Because here, I can see here's Yahshua. He's going through the motions, you know, going by the pattern. I'm not going to get on that time. But he's culminating on the mount, on the Sermon on the Mount. He's in the flesh,
right?
Or he's in a physical body. That would be in a type, that would be like a white robe,
mm-hmm.
plain clothes. Here he is, Mount of Transfiguration. He transfigured before them, but he went up there in the flesh,
right?
Physical body,
right?
Okay, linen garments or white clothes, linen garments.
Yeah.
Here is death, burial, resurrection. Here he's physical,
right?
Goes in the tomb, physical,
yes,
but comes out a quickening spirit.
Right.
Yeah.
He's changed clothes. Mm-hmm. Now he's in the garments of beauty and glory. A quickening spirit. See here. See. That's why I say on the Day of Atonement, see, that's what he was wearing based on. Yahshua was fulfilling jot and tittle.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to see him fulfill. If he's fulfilling jot and tittle, that's what you have to look for.
Right, correct.
You have to look for these things. Now, coming over here, because see here, we got this. We got Yahshua appearing universally so. And when we say universally, right. That includes the
physical and the angelic creation. So when we say everybody will be present, believe me, everybody will be present.
Right, right.
Who has ever lived on the face of the earth, every angel, they will be there.
Yeah.
And everybody will see, every eye will see him. Mm-hmm. No matter what eye, you figure the eye, this eye, that inner eye. Because he's going to appear here. Now here, when he appears, we who are in him now, right now, physically, we appear with him. Those who are not, they appear. That's why you see these nice bright colored clothes
outside.
Here. See these nice bright colored clothes here represent concepts, opinions, theories, the things that we clothed ourselves about. What the first speaker alluded to over here. These patchwork. See?
Right. Mm-hmm.
These filthy rags that we picked up.
Yeah.
See, Frankenstein's monster. You know, Frankenstein created his monster. Where did he get it from?
Graveyard.
Dead parts from the cemetery.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's what we did with these cotton when we created that egotistical, misdirected personality. Where did we get it? We got it from the graveyard, the world.
Yeah. Right.
These dead concepts, these dead theories, opinions, and we created it.
Mm-hmm.
We created ourselves in the image of the world. And now, here, it will be revealed that that image was the wrong image.
Very good. Mm-hmm.
And since it was made, since it was based on flesh, then flesh is subject to fire. Now, what are we talking about? Talking about a flame? No, we're talking about a transmutation.
Yeah.
See, this is descending. Because we said that, the scripture said that Yahshua shall descend
with
a shout.
Mm-hmm.
See, now everything goes in here.
Yeah.
And see, and then we got the renovation of the earth. What are you talking about? See, what are you talking about? See, us, the bride, that's really what it's talking about. Mm. See, up here, we were made, the woman was made, you know, was taken out of the man, and made subject to vanity, but she was made subject in hope. Likewise, that hope, who is Yahshua Messiah, see, what this is really showing you is him, the woman, being totally reconciled unto the new earth state, that is to say, us being in him,
right.
The woman being clothed with the Son in totality. Right now, when everything is, how can I put it? In part, Elohim transmuted himself in part, not in totality. But here, how can I put it? The woman clothed in the Son.
Mm-hmm.
We have that now.
Mm-hmm.
We have that. Immortal spirit dwelling in a physical body.
It's not a full end.
Right. But here, it's a full end.
Right.
Because here, the renovation of it, that's a full end.
Right.
Okay. See, and here, we're going up into, see, what is that scripture? 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. I think it's 15, 22 maybe? Somewhere around there.
Unified.
1 Corinthians 15:22. For as in Adam all die, even so in the Messiah shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Messiah the first fruits.
Mm-hmm.
Afterward they are his at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to Yahweh, even the Father,
mm-hmm.
when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet.
Mm-hmm.
The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death,
mm-hmm.
for he hath put all things under his feet.
Mm-hmm.
But when he saith all things...
Now here's all things under his feet. See, this is him, the earth, him standing on the earth. I know what is illustrated here, but look at... It's the
right.
same thing as here.
Mm-hmm.
See,
yes.
This is the renovation of it. So now, descending.
Ascending.
Ascending.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Read.
For he hath put all things under his feet.
Uh-huh.
But when he saith all things
uh-huh.
are under him,
uh-huh.
it is manifest that he is accepted.
Now he is accepted or excluded. Read.
Which put all things under
which
him.
Which put all things under him. Read.
When all things shall be subdued unto him,
uh-huh.
then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him.
Now see, now you can put this into the ages. See, this is the end of the age, the present age. This is the renovation of the earth, going into the fifth age, new earth state. The veil here is the sixth age, and the seventh age is the sabbatical age. And it is the same way as we told you about the high priest, except this time, this is Melchizedek.
Mm-hmm.
Going up in here. See, he's going up behind the veil of inscrutability, going up in here. Keep reading.
And that put all things under him, that
uh-huh.
Yahweh may be all in all.
That's what it says here, all in all. Because now he's gone behind the veil. Draw a line. to our life. Because that's how did it get started? He came out from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility.
Yeah.
He came out from behind that. So now over here, draw a line right here. He's going back behind the veil.
Yeah.
This is the seventh age.
Yeah.
The sabbat, that's why it says Sabbath. Sabbatical age. And see, in the eighth age is him coming out from behind the veil.
Mm.
That's this right here.
Yeah.
Seven ages completed. Seven stars in his hand. Talking about the seven new ages. And it ain't seven Elohims. It's just one Elohim being made manifested.
Right.
Seven ages.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's him coming out from behind. Just like the high priest came out from behind here at the end of the last sacrifice and threw down the censer and said, it is finished. It's the same way here. He's coming out here behind the veil. Seven completed ages. It is finished. That is the end of the seven ages, and now we're at the beginning of a seven new ages.
Mm-hmm.
See, and that's him. See, and it's, but to understand this, we have to understand the types and the shadows of the Levitical priesthood.
Because,
see, this is Melchizedek.
Melchizedek.
This is Melchizedek. King and high priest of Salem, or king and high priest of peace.
Right.
And listen, he's at the end of the seven ages. That means that the seven ages has been cleansed.
Yeah.
All of that.
Mm-hmm.
See, once and for all, Melchizedek. See, that's him. And listen, the bride is within him.
That's right.
Because he's got the 12 stones up. The bride is within him.
Yeah.
In the bosom.
See, she is there. See.
Back in there.
Redeemed.
Complete.
See.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Just as it was in the beginning.
Because
see, here, see look, we say this all the time, and I'll sit down because I know we're out of time. Here, we show him naked and nude.
Right.
What this is, and see, here's the tabernacle, but the veils are up.
Right.
What this is showing with him naked, it's showing him being hidden.
Right, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
But now here, the veils are open. We can see the interior.
Mm-hmm.
He's fully clothed.
Very good.
Why? Now it's showing that he is now fully revealed.
Yeah.
Now, mind you, you can take this and these are all, you know, and look at it types and shit, because see, in the reality, we're already there.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
But we have to go through, though. We just got to go through the motions. I know I'm hurting, my feet's aching and all that, but still.
Yeah.
See, that's what Paul said, you know, if you only knew, you could see it, just a glimpse of what Yahweh has in store. Yes.
I still don't understand about the scapegoat, because you said something about going for the sins, the animal sacrifice.
Yeah.
You mean like Yahshua being sacrificed for the sin of whoever brought it?
Well, Yahshua's fulfilling all of that.
So is that animal, right, that sacrifice.
Yeah.
So
okay.
What is the scapegoat doing then?
Well, the scapegoat is God.
Why are they sending this?
The Yahshua took on our sins.
And so did the animal
so he had to fulfill both.
Mm-hmm.
So he's the scapegoat, so he took two goats. So when he prayed over the goats,
uh-huh.
he's taking on the sins of the people.
All
and
right.
then he sends them out.
Sins are transferred onto
to
the
him.
Scapegoat.
Oh, I see.
Mm-hmm. And that's a scapegoat, because Yahshua had to fulfill being the scapegoat.
Uh-huh.
And then he also had to fulfill the sins of the people as well.
Yeah.
But Yahshua, who did no sin, he took on sin and came into life as a sinful flesh. So therefore, they had to have two goats, the scapegoat and the goats for the cleansing of for the heirs of the people.
Mm-hmm.
So they sent one out, and then at the end of the day, he fulfilled both of them.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Nothing escapes.
I'm glad you're so good with that. But yeah, that's in conclusion, I'll say this. Take the time to read.
Right.
Take the time to read. Dr. Kelly said it best. You got a book.
Mm-hmm.
Read it sometime. Read the scriptures. Be familiar with them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not asking you to wrestle out what is this spiritually. Just be familiar with the story. I mean, you know, just be familiar with it.
Yeah.
Research something. If it's something you don't know, research it. There's encyclopedias, dictionaries, or words you don't understand. And then rehearse the matter. And see, allow Yahweh to reveal it to you.
Bless you.
Excuse me.
And see, if you take the time to understand the pattern, the correlations between the migratory tract and the pattern, again, read Moses. Yahweh, not I, but Yahweh will quicken your efforts. Allow him to prove to you
satisfaction
that he is, you know, who he says he is, that he is a revealer of secrets. And not me or anybody else that's standing in front of this floor. See, you only hear maybe once, twice a week or whatever, but see, but you're away from here, you know, whatever. See, Yahweh speaks to us 24/7.
Thank you.
Allow Yahweh the opportunity to reveal himself to you.
Thank you.
Because he's already there
right
in you. And with those
Pentecost to stay here forever. Very good. Good class. Can you Samuel?
Thank you, buddy. Oh, gracias.
Bien hecho.
Gracias, gracias.
Oh, the address for this class is...
Well, the truth, we thank the Father for allowing us to have class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. And the fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. All donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless.
And
after I dismiss class, I will write the address to the meeting that we're going to next Sunday. Let everybody know that's listening out there on the phone that there will not be any class held here next Sunday because we're going to Glendale, California.
What's the address?
I'm going to put it, I think I'm going to put it on a board after I dismiss class.
Okay.
I got it right here.
Okay. Please.
So come back again to study Buddhist, bring your friends and all your enemies, and stand for the doxology.
Thank you much.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign. Belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all times, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Señor
Salas,
Williams.
Yes, sir.
Beautiful.
Oh, thank
beautiful.
You, sir.
El este la diste es una hoja y de la otra también.
No, no más una.
No, no,
oh, son dos.
Oh,
sí.
Two trips. I seen it when it came to me, man. That's gorgeous, man. This is now. You know, this thing what Rip was talking about. But you see the purpose. I mean, you see
it's the principle.
Yeah, the principle.
That's all.
He's just looking for the principle.
Yeah, so
how are you going to figure out when he put the garments to be a glory, you know? Then it nailed me right there.
As I said, you gotta have a workable knowledge. I mean, it says right there in the album, but workable knowledge. That's what you strive for, you know. And that's just an example.
Yeah, a lot of workable knowledge.
I get twisted after the moments. That's usually where I get mixed up on what work stuff is. But now that
Melchizedek. And he used to say Los Angeles.
The true name of Los Angeles, Nuestra Señora de Los Angeles. Nuestra Señora.
Our Lady.
Yeah.
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 They said, what
else?
Let me borrow your pen, man. Who's in here?
There's a whole bottle full of
pen.
I'll give it to you.
No.
I got
your other receipt in there.
Did you get my liver?
What's the main press treat?
Just Google it. You'll see it on the map.
Put it in with you.
Yeah.
And at what time?
It's